of the land on which this cathedral church is built, the Pangang people, and we acknowledge the elders past, present, and future.
The Anointed One has come to proclaim the good news of his favour and forgiveness. Let us humbly confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident that he will save us and raise us up. Lord Jesus,
Lord, have mercy. reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's witness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness, sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
beginning at verse 20.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "So we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The crowd answered him, "We have heard from the law that the Messiah remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" Jesus said to them, "The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light." After Jesus had said this, he departed and hid from them. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Managed to come to our Chrism Mass yesterday, but she didn't get dressed. She said, "I she don't feel like I quite belong here yet. So she's still, her heart's still here in Wang, I think. I want to do something quite dangerous this morning and talk about humility. It's a very tricky thing for a clergy person to speak about humility, and even worse for a bishop to speak about humility, because most of us are spectacular failures in humility. But this week, as we move from Palm Sunday through the Passion to the Resurrection, we can't help but be struck by the humility of Jesus. Coming into Jerusalem, the holy city, on a donkey, fulfilling prophecies of old, and yet Jesus knew what the end was. And so it must have been painful for him to receive the shouts of praise and acclamation, knowing how quickly they would change. And then on Thursday night in the upper room, Jesus washing his disciples' feet as a sign of humility and reminding them by his actions that he came to serve and not to be served. And then, of course, the betrayal in the garden and the abandonment by those in whom he had placed his trust. The humility, in fact, humiliation that went with the stripping and scourging, and then being forced to rely on a stranger from the country to help carry the instrument of his death. And then the humiliation of dying on the cross with two common criminals, and yet Jesus speaks to them with humility and love and even a word of hope. And then the humility of being in someone else's grave, not even a spot set apart for him in particular. And then on Easter morning, no great triumphant shout, but an encounter with Mary in the garden, who doesn't quite recognise him. He comes humbly to greet those who have come to the tomb. And then later in the day, walking alongside the two disciples going to Emmaus, not saying, well, I'm back, guys, let's have a party, but just walking along with them, letting them come to understand who he is in their own good time. The humility of standing before Thomas and saying, I know you don't believe, so have a bit of touchy-feely to see what happens. Throughout these days, as we come to the celebration of the resurrection and then beyond, we are reminded sharply that the one we serve is above all a humble servant of those he came to save. Now, I'm sure it's not true in the Diocese of Wangaratta, but in the Diocese of Ballarat, I reckon half the complaints I get from lay people about the clergy is that they are bossy. They're too much in control and don't exercise authority properly. And it's perilously easy for us to forget what true humility means. It's a word that in the general community is out of favour because people think it means being a doormat for others. But true humility is absolutely the opposite of that. And those of us who have the privilege and responsibility of leading God's people ought to be sharply attuned to how we are humble in the way we serve after the pattern of our Master, and as we show others what it means to be caught up in the kingdom of Jesus. A couple of years ago, just in the middle of the pandemic, a bloke called Charles Stepanek wrote a wonderful book about humility, and he talks about humility because he was a Baptist or a Brethren or something, minister, who for 25 years felt that he was altogether unworthy, altogether totally depraved, altogether not humble at all. Because he thought humility was something about denying self and giving over, enjoying success So Stepanek had a road to a Damascus experience, a road to Emmaus experience, an epiphany, where he thought deeply about what it was to be a humble servant of the humble Son of God. He came up with 8 marks of humility for the modern clergy person. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach for 10 minutes on each of them. They are really worthwhile things to remind us of what it means to actually be humble in leading God's people. Firstly, Stepanek says, those who are leaders must above all else be authentic. And authenticity is the major key to discovering how you, in particular, can lead humble lives. Second, he says we need to be confident in God's love for us and in his forgiveness of our sinfulness, so that we're not bowed down by false humility or by putting ourselves down endlessly, but that we have the confidence of being people who have been forgiven and loved and are truly free. Which leads, he says, to the third mark of true humility, which is a deep gratitude, something that wells up from deep within us as we give thanks for God's goodness to us and the privilege of being good to God's people. I was talking to some SSM people recently, Society of Sacred Mission. They're just about finished in Australia. But I was lucky to grow up in Adelaide, where about half the priests were trained by SSM. They're marked by 2 things. One is provisionality. They were really committed to careful and rigorous theology. They weren't committed to thinking that they were always right. They were committed to embracing new understandings and new things as they came along. And the second thing about them was that while they were personally very disciplined, they were very generous in dealing with those in their pastoral care. They had a deep sense of gratitude for their own salvation, for their own forgiveness, and so could easily offer that to others. You won't be surprised if the fourth of Stepanek's marks of true humility is love, a love that's based on self-giving, based on that self-offering that we see in Jesus, particularly during his Holy Week. The fifth mark that he mentions is praise, that we should be people who are generous in offering praise to others, in receiving praise, but not letting it become too important to us, but knowing how important it is in building up others in the faith, in edifying the people of God, when we can genuinely praise them. I always think that's one of the hardest things to do. You know, if I'm visiting a parish council, they're being totally unreasonable. I think, now what can I say that will help build them up in the faith? It's a really important that we take seriously our role to praise those in our care. Because people do it with their kids easily, but we don't think about how we do it with each other in adult life. But praise is a key that sets people free. The last three are sort of the same thing, really. I don't know, perhaps Stepanek was looking to fill out a couple of extra chapters. But they're the same sort of idea. Empowerment, mentoring, and breaking down the barriers around us. So authenticity, confidence, gratitude, love, praise, empowerment, mentoring, and breaking down barriers. They're not usually the things we think of when we talk about humility. But you can see each of those characteristics lived out spectacularly in the life of Jesus. And sometimes we even glimpse pictures of humility in our own communities, where we see some of those characteristics lived out. I mentioned 3 things. Firstly is the office. Saying the office. It takes a great deal of humility to say your prayers regularly and faithfully. There are always far more important things to do. And anyway, I I'm doing a special study of 2 Corinthians at the moment. Haven't got time to read all those endless readings of morning and evening prayer, especially Numbers, which I hate. The great thing about saying the office is it reminds us we are just a speck in the ocean of prayer and in God's story. And it shapes our hearts as we read the scriptures year after year after year. Our hearts are gradually conformed to the sort of heart that God wants us to have. The office is sometimes unbelievably boring. And then occasionally you get a hilarious passage where you can hardly read it because it's so crazy. Some of it's unbelievably gory and ghastly. But the office is a way in which we can shape our hearts and minds in the way of the servant king. You know, on Thursday night we always get that wonderful thing from Philippians. Christ Jesus was in the form of God but did not cling to equality with God. It's like a slap in the face. We've had a grumpy day. We've had to be really mean to some of the clergy. We've had another lot of professional standard stuff to deal with. And then there's the canting of an evening prayer, saying, Garry, remember who you serve. Try and put on some humility for the rest of the day. So can I encourage you, whether you're a good prayer, or whether you're a bit lax, or whether you sort of plain get in evening prayer but don't manage morning prayer much, try and take seriously your responsibility to pray the office, because it shapes your heart and your mind so that you can be truly a humble leader. The second thing I want to suggest is that we need to be humble with those who are in leadership in our parishes. They can be the most intensely aggravating people in our lives. Church wardens in particular are often very helpful and aggravating beyond the extreme at the same time. I don't know about you, but going to parish council meetings when I was a parish priest was always torture, because you'd think, what's going to come out of left field today? But if we come to the structural parts of our work with a deep sense of humility, we can find in the difficult church world the face of Christ. And we can find in that very painful treasury person and their pernickety pulling apart of the financial statements, we can see something of their passion for the things of God in their own language. So try and find ways in which, when you're dealing with your church wardens and with your parish councils, that you can do some of those things that Stepanek talks about. Be authentic. You know, don't be a doormat. Don't be ridiculous. But be confident and grateful and loving and give plenty of praise and try and build people up in their faith and love. The third thing is a bit tricky, but I want to suggest that we need to be very careful in our relationships with each other as clergy, and particularly our relationship with the bishop. It's a very tricky thing to be a bishop. I've been at it for 23 years now, and it's no easier than it was the day I started. And I don't know that I'm very good at humility. I try very hard not to be a bishop who bosses people around and exercises control. A wonderful little Celia Hahn book from the Auburn Institute that talks about the difference between control and authority. Control is something you impose on others. Authority is something others give you. In our relationships with each other, amongst the clergy, and particularly with the bishop, we want to be people who are interested not in control, but in authority. Taking responsibility and the things others offer us and with gratitude and humility, but never trying to exercise control, even if we think we know best of all what we're doing. I used an illustration yesterday in the Chrism Mass in my diocese, talking about the personal nature of humility. A couple of weeks ago, the Dean and I and one woman were left after an evening function. There were lots of coffee cups to wash up and put away. And Louise was doing the washing. I got a tea towel and went in and started drying. And the Dean leaned in through the hatch and said, "Well, thanks very much, folks, I'm going home." And I picked up the tea towel and tossed it through the hatch and said, "No, you're not coming here." And I thought, yeah, well, I was trying to be, you know, encouraging and humble service. One of the clergy afterwards said, "It was great, Bishop, you showed how bossy you can be in encouraging our humility." Whatever you might think about humility, I hope you do think about it sometimes and think about what it means for you as a deacon or as a priest or an archdeacon or a retired cleric. What it means for you to be a servant leader of the servant king. True humility is never about putting ourselves down, but about being real and knowing whose we are and whom we serve. Let me finish with a little story. I've read a lot of the books by a fellow called Shusaku Endo, a Japanese Christian writer who died only a couple of years ago. His most famous book is called Silence, and it tells the story of one of the last priests left in Japan after the Tokugawa regime excluded all the clergy and executed everybody who claimed to be a Christian. As happened, a few priests remained in hiding and went from village to village celebrating Mass and the other sacraments. And eventually this priest is caught and put in jail and knows that he has to come before the magistrate in the morning to either deny his faith and be set free or affirm his faith and be executed. In order for people to deny Christ, the Tokugawa had plates made out of bronze with a picture of the crucifixion engraved into them, and they were put on the ground. And if somebody was suspected of being a Christian, they were required to stamp on the plate and say, "I reject him." And so this priest is thinking, "My whole life I've tried to serve." And then in the morning he comes before the magistrate, and the fumi, the plate, is on the ground, and the guy with the sharp sword, the executioner, is standing by, and the magistrate says to him, "Are you a Christian? If you are, step on the fumi and deny Christ." And the priest looks down at the image of the crucifixion engraved on the plate and longs to hear the voice of God. He spent his whole life trying to serve Jesus, trying to be a faithful and good priest. And now he feels the temptation very strongly to save his life by stepping on the fumi. He pauses and the magistrate asks him again to step on the fumi and deny Jesus. And he looks down, and the person on the cross speaks to him and says, "Step on me. That's why I came. Step on me. That's why I came."
My sisters and brothers, at his last supper, our Lord Jesus Christ gave his disciples a new commandment, that they should love one another, and he prayed that they may be one. He gave them an everlasting sign of his own love, In the sacrament of bread and wine, I invite you now to dedicate yourselves afresh to God's service, as stewards of the mysteries of God and as ministers of God's grace. At your ordination as a deacon, you received the yoke of Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve. Will you continue faithfully in this ministry to build up God's people in God's truth and service in God's name?
By the help of God, I will.
At your ordination to the priesthood, you took authority to watch over the care for God's people, to absolve and bless them in God's name, to proclaim the gospel of salvation, and to minister the sacraments of the new covenant. Will you continue as faithful stewards of the mysteries of God, preaching the gospel of Christ and ministering his holy sacraments?
By the help of God, I will.
And now, I too, before God and you, dedicate myself and reaffirm the promises made when I was consecrated. And I ask you to pray for me in my ministry.
We will continue to pray for you and support you in your ministry as our bishop.
Sisters and brothers, through our baptism, Christ calls us to minister. Do you commit yourself in loving service alongside your bishop and clergy?
I do, Lord, in my heart.
Gracious and holy God, we pray for the minister, that they may be constant in prayer, steadfast in faith, and serve the people with joy. Lord,
hear us.
We pray for all deacons, that you may pour upon them the riches of your grace, as you have called them into your service. May you make them worthy of that calling.
Lord, hear us.
We pray for all priests, that you will bless them in the fullness of your love, so that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments, and lead your people in the way of salvation.
Lord, hear us.
We pray for all bishops, that despite our unworthiness, we may be faithful to the great trust that has been handed to us, and that we may become like our good shepherd and great high priest, the teacher and servant of all, and so become more and more a sign of Christ's loving presence among God's people.
Lord, hear us.
We pray for our families and for those who minister, for their homes and for all with whom they share their lives.
Lord, hear us.
Gracious God, in your love keep us ever close to you, and may you bring us all to the fullness of eternal life.
Amen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Sovereign God, gentle and merciful, Creator in heaven and earth. Your word brought light out of darkness, and daily your Spirit renews the face of the earth. You anointed your Son, brought healing to those in weakness and distress. Jesus broke the power of evil and set us free from sin and death, that we might praise your name forever. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may your blessing rest on those who are anointed with this oil in your name. May they be made whole in body, mind, and spirit, restored in your image, renewed in your love, and serve you as daughters and sons in your kingdom.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Sovereign God, the protector of all who believe in you. Your Christ overcame the powers of evil, lifted high upon the cross. By the power of your Spirit, may your blessing rest on those who are anointed with the oil in your name. As they prepare for the waters of baptism, may it be for them a sign of your defense in their fight against sin, the world, and the devil, and bring them to share in Christ's victory.
Blessed be God forever.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Sovereign God, Creator of all that is, upholding by your grace all who hear your call. Under your covenant, priests, kings, and queens were anointed to serve you, and in the fullness of time you anointed your Son by the Holy Spirit to be the Christ, the Saviour and servant of all. By the power of your Spirit, may your blessing rest on those who are anointed with this chrism in your name. Let it be for them a sign of joy and gladness, as they share in the royal priesthood of the new covenant, and make known the kingdom of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit we lift our voice of thanks and praise.
Praise to God, our strength and our salvation, now and
forever. Partly I'm here today in my capacity as the Chair of the Advisory Council on Anglican Religious Life in Australia. And you're about to witness a pretty unique event. I think I've been at three in my whole ministry, and there are, I think, nine people in Australia who have formally made commitments to live a single consecrated life. Now, this is not something that's just happened overnight. Passing fad for Eden. That's something that she's been talking to the Advisory Council about for the last 3 years, and we've asked her to wait and to do some more prayerful discernment, and the Council has now agreed that it seems appropriate for Eden to make her first vows in a single consecrated life. What does that mean? Well, it means that she'll take a vow of celibacy and that she will live according to her own rule, and that her vow will be held by her bishop, that is, by Bishop Clarence. After one or two or three renewals, she'll be invited, if she wishes, to make a lifelong commitment. Single consecrated life people don't live in religious communities, and they don't have extensive rules to follow. They choose how they live out their Christian life. They are usually solitary, and they commit themselves particularly to a life of prayer and witness. So it's a great joy to be here with you all and Eden today as she takes this important step and is consecrated as a single to single consecrated life.
Bishop Garry, I present Eden Elizabeth Nichols, who wishes to make a temporary vows for admission to single consecrated life. I support and affirm her in this request.
Eden Elizabeth, what do you see? Eden Elizabeth, are you resolved to live in the state of celibacy and in the service of God and God's Church? Are you resolved to accept consecration in a single life, following the example of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who gave his life for the salvation of the world? Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, let us pray to God Almighty. God the Almighty Father, through his Son Jesus Christ, that he will pour out the Holy Spirit on Eden Elizabeth, his servant, whom he has called to be consecrated in his service. We keep a moment of silent prayer for Eden Elizabeth.
I now invite Eden Elizabeth to make her profession. loving Father, you have loved and redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. He is your Word, through whom all things were made. Look with favour on this, your servant, even Elizabeth, who has resolved to follow you in the holy state of celibacy. You have inspired her to make this vow, and she now gives you her heart. Lord, protect even Elizabeth, as she desires to be strengthened by your blessing and consecration. Loving Father, through the gift of your Holy Spirit, give even Elizabeth chastity with right judgment, kindness with true wisdom, gentleness with strength of character, freedom with purity of heart. Give her the gift of love to love you above all others. May her life deserve your praise, without seeking to be praised. May she give you glory by holiness of life, by herself, her glory, joy, and whole desire. Be a comfort in sorrow, her wisdom in perplexity, her protection in the midst of injustice, her patience in adversity, her riches in poverty, her food in fasting, her remedy in sickness. Even Elizabeth has chosen you above all things. May she find all things in possessing you. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
Amen.
Lord, bless and hallow this cross as the outward sign of the vow that Elizabeth has made this day. Lord, bless and hallow this ring as the outward sign of the vow that Eden Elizabeth had made this day. Eden Elizabeth, receive this book that contains the prayers of the Church. May the praise of our Heavenly Father be always on your lips. Pray without ceasing for the salvation of the whole world. The God who inspires all holy desires and brings them to fulfillment, may he protect you always by his grace, so that you may fulfill the duties of your vocation with a faithful heart.
Amen.
May God make you a witness and a sign of love for all people.
Amen.
May God make those bonds with which you have bound you to Christ on earth endure forever. Sisters and brothers in Christ, I present you Eden Elizabeth, who has been received into temporary vows for single consecrated life. Christ has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through goodness we have his gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Bless you, God, forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honor be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. He offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. When his hour had come, in his great love he gave the supper to his disciples, that we might proclaim his death and feast with him in his kingdom. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. But if it dies, it bears much fruit.
If we die in Christ, we shall live.
Thank you.
Good Shepherd, you have welcomed us at your table and have anointed us with the oil of gladness. May your goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our life, that we may dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Most loving God,
you send us into the world of love. Give us grace to live and thank you and our flesh in the power of your Spirit.
Amen. door within this place. Also, let me extend a great word of thanks to Bishop Garry. It is lovely to have him here. He always quotes me and says, "How is my best bishop of Wangaratta?" And I said, "Yes, fine, my favorite bishop of Ballarat." But thank you so much, Garry. You know, in 2020, my first chrism service was via Zoom, and you were able to share with us. And today we come for a double blessing to share God's word in what I live by and live for, a ministry of humble service. And also to induct Eden, who have desired and sought this pathway for her life over the last few years. So it is very great to have you with us. And thank you so much for being here. Also want to say thank you to Eden for her patience and understanding, for the tears shed for this moment. But they always say joy comes in the morning. Joy is here today for you. And also, a grateful thanks to all of you who are present, who have come. I do think that this is one of our best attended for clergy, these services of the Chrism Mass. And maybe it's because we are being restored from the time of COVID to where we are now. We have prepared some, I think, good food for you at the Bishop's Lodge. I'm going to ask you, if you would indulge, as you walk through that little lane, commonly known as Bishop's Lane, that you take the first big gate and that you follow the footpath on, it's a longer path, so you might get there eventually, but the cement block path, because like here, the cockatoos are creating havoc on the other side. I almost slipped twice this morning. So if you want to dare to walk across the grass, you will do so at your own risk. Please just pass. Do not enter the chapel or the kitchen, but just go around, and there's enough space, place, food and drink for all of us. The last time I checked, we had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. It is really great to have members of our congregation share with us here today. You all have received those who are eligible for synod envelopes from Fiona. If you have not, please do collect your envelopes because they will not be posted. That is for you, your representatives, and for the synod elections and an election form. The God of grace clothe you with holiness.
Amen.
The Son of righteousness pour upon you the riches of his grace.
Amen.
The Spirit of wisdom strengthen you in your ministry.
Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you.